the FT took it seriously. This was probably, you know, the biggest financial event in, you know, the last, well, since the war. Almost no mainstream newspaper even noticed it was happening. I mean, it was extraordinary, which tells you something, I think, about how out of touch journalists had got with what was going on in the real financial world that affects our lives. Also tells you, of course, an enormous amount. The Treasury didn't really understand what was going on. Bank of England didn't really understand what was going on. We'd just taken for granted that financial markets would just function to raise money. It never occurred to anybody that they could just close down in this way. Why is it, you know, when these banks went down and impoverished all of us, you know, nobody running a bank went to prison? The answer is, amazingly, that destroying a bank is not a crime. It is true that on most very conventional measures, when it comes to income, the gap between rich and poor since the crash has narrowed. Why has it narrowed? Because so many people's incomes collapsed, and as it happens, the state benefits system broadly rewards, works on the basis that benefits are uprated, they've changed a bit, but by the rate of inflation, that when people were forced onto more benefits or more tax credits, they actually got what rises in payments from the state that were faster than people slightly further up the income scale were getting from their employment. When you look at wealth, you know, the gap between rich and poor has widened in a most mind-boggling way.
In the profession we're going to talk about later, the world of football, I mean, it is staggering. The sums of money are absolutely staggering, and it has completely corrupted the soul of that world.
A Wayne Rooney, right, will earn in a year probably a multiple of what you earned in a lifetime.
Probably, yeah. I mean, his week's wages would probably have passed what I earned in my career.
I mean, just mind-boggling. You were an incredibly talented, brilliant player. Do you think there is any correlation between money and quality of what we see?
Well, first of all, I think that when I actually come into the game, my £5 a week didn't go very far, but what's happened in football is obviously companies, you know, have come into the game. I think Arsenal were actually the last, as a company, a limited company, we were the last team to go into advertising. The club didn't think it was suitable. But nowadays you have to, because if you want to entice the great players or the players that earn vast amounts of money and that can generate people coming through the turnstiles, then you have to pay them accordingly. We play because we love the club. Yeah. I think it's changed a little bit. We have seen a few people move here, there and everywhere, and the main sort of point of moving is to make more money. That wasn't the case when we actually played football. But there was, you could go back to the 1930s or 50s when there was great players, so Stanley Matthews, Tom Finney, were earning a lot less than us and probably getting a lift to work on a milk on the horse and cart which delivered milk. When we won the double in 70-71, the total earnings for the whole 17 players, with bonuses included, come to the grand total of about £350,000. Thierry Henry, one of the great players, a superstar, 7 years ago, he used to earn that in a month at Arsenal.